For regular videos on ancient cultures and forgotten civilizations, please subscribe.
Hi, I was just listening to my voicemails. You might find this one interesting.
Hello, Professor. I would like to know more about dating. For example, when historians, archaeologists, and also pseudo-historians using the term carbon dating. I would like to know other methods of dating and when they can be applied. What is their range and accuracy? Thank you, Professor.
And thank you for your question. Since you mentioned carbon dating, I am assuming you're referring to the dating of material remains. And yes, it seems a lot of people have heard about carbon dating, but not many other forms. So let's go over the important ones. It's good to keep in mind that we have relative dating methods and absolute dating methods. Relative dating methods involve organizing artifacts, deposits, and societies in sequences. It determines whether something is older or younger than something else. One way to determine relative dates of items is stratigraphy, that is the study of stratification. What's that? Stratification is a process by which layers of natural and cultural debris are laid down. A stratum of debris on top of another stratum indicates that the one on top was deposited afterward. The basic principle is that artifacts that are in lower strata are earlier, artifacts that are in higher strata are later, and artifacts that are in the same stratum are contemporaneous. So if you look at a succession of layers from the side, you're being given a relative chronological sequence from the earliest on the bottom to the latest on the top. Keep in mind that this does not mean that every artifact lower is earlier and every artifact higher is later. Just because one item is on top of another, that doesn't mean it is later. What matters is what stratum they are in. If they are in the same stratum, even if one's higher than the other, they're contemporary. I've seen people say that if a building stone is underneath another building stone, then it must be older. And yes, the one underneath was placed first, but if they're found in the same stratum, they are contemporary. Now you might say, wait, but what if the strata have been tampered with or messed up in some way? Ah yes, that happens. And archaeologists know they can't sequence material in disturbed strata. Fortunately, by doing enough excavation at a site, the original strata and the disturbed strata can be differentiated. Another matter to be concerned with is whether an artifact, like a ceramic pot, for example, was old or new when deposited in the layer. If it was found in the remains of someone's house, we can understand it to have been in use at the time the house was lived in. But if it was found in an ancient garbage dump, it would have been used earlier than the time the garbage dump was made, right? Overall, however, stratigraphy is a great way to determine sequence. But by itself, a sequence is not anchored to a timeline. It needs an absolute dating method to do that. Another form of sequencing is typological sequencing. This is the arrangement of human creations, art, artifacts, buildings, etc., chronologically. Distinctive shapes and decorations. Basically, what I'm talking about is style. Change over time. Often this will be based on improvements in technology, but also just on what happens to be fashionable. If I asked you to sequence car styles through time, you could probably do it, though of course that is because you have a basic knowledge of it. But the same can be done with artifacts. And stratigraphy also helps in this case. Artifacts produced at the same time are often alike, so sequencing them across archaeological sites can be accomplished. Every time new artifacts are dug up, they can be compared to a well-established sequence, and the relative time of their manufacture can be determined. Pottery is probably the most valuable artifact to sequence because its decorations change the most rapidly, sometimes over periods of just a few decades. By using this method, archaeologists can arrange artifact styles in serial order to indicate their relative chronology. You asked about range and accuracy, so in regard to these relative dating methods, their range is unlimited. They can apply to any material remains. Their accuracy increases the more material remains that are found. Okay, so let's talk about absolute dating, which gives us the age of an artifact in years. The most commonly known is carbon dating, also known as radiocarbon dating, which you mentioned. Carbon gets into both plants and animals. After it oxidizes, plants absorb it through photosynthesis, and animals absorb it indirectly by eating plants, or eating other animals that ate plants. Plants and animals absorb both carbon-12 and carbon-14, the latter of which is very rare. And while they are alive, they generally have 1 trillion times more carbon-12 than carbon-14 in their bodies. After they die, an interesting change takes place. They retain the carbon-12, but lose the carbon-14. Carbon-14 is radioactive and unstable, so it decays over time. We can measure how much carbon-12 and carbon-14 is in organic matter. It is therefore possible to measure how long a plant or animal has been dead based on the ratio of carbon-14 to carbon-12 within it. This technique is considered accurate to about 50,000 years. Why? Going back further, the amount of carbon-14 becomes just too minuscule to be measured. By the way, the dates ascertained from radiometric measurements are done according to a neutral international system for dating, and that is using a date BP, before present. But it isn't really before present, because the present year changes with each passing year, so they had to decide on a set year, and they chose 1950 to count back from. So if you see a date BP, know that it means before 1950, not actually before the present. It's getting old now, right? We're in the next century, so they're probably going to change it, I expect, sometime soon. Then there is tree ring dating, also known as dendrochronology. In archaeology, it is used two ways: as a method of absolute dating, and as a way to calibrate dates calculated through carbon dating. Here is the reasoning behind tree ring dating. Generally speaking, a tree produces one ring per year, right? The more a tree grows in a particular year, the larger the space between the ring it makes and the one from the year before. Narrow growth rings are caused either by old age or by lower rainfall and less sunlight. Felled trees in a certain region have been compared with each other, and their tree rings have been matched up. This ring and this stump corresponds with this ring and that stump, so that we now have existing rings corresponding to every year, starting in the present and going back thousands of years. This is not global, it's just in certain areas. But in those areas, if we find, say, a wooden object, timber, used in a house, for example, we can see when that tree was chopped down. So we know when the house was built. Tree ring dating also can be linked with carbon dating because we can carbon date trees. Thermoluminescence dating can determine the time that pottery, baked clay, burnt stone, and even in some cases burnt soil were heated to a temperature over 500 degrees Celsius. Minerals, when they're exposed to radiation, accumulate energy at a uniform rate over time. When minerals are heated to a sufficient temperature, they release all the energy and their radiation clock starts over. By reheating samples from these objects, scientists measure the thermoluminescence released, and hence can date the firing of the material. Have you ever heard people say, you can't carbon date stones? True, but you can optical date them. Optically stimulated luminescence dating is similar to thermoluminescence dating and sometimes gets confused with it. I've gotten them mixed up before. But instead of dating when an object was exposed to heat, this dates when an object was last exposed to light. In other words, we can tell when it was buried. Thermoluminescence and optically stimulated luminescence are considered accurate up to about 100,000 years ago. Obsidian hydration dating can be used for both relative dating and absolute dating. If a culture using stone tools knew about obsidian, it's almost certain that they would have used it, because obsidian can create very sharp edges and break in predictable ways. Obsidian accumulates a rind over time, and when you break it, the newly exposed surface will start accumulating a new rind. So by measuring the rind, you theoretically can see how long it has been since the break. Since a break made by human hands is usually when a tool is being made, this can be useful to know. Relative dating is straightforward. By measuring the thickness of the rind, you can easily determine if one artifact in a certain area is older than another. And if you know the rate at which water diffuses into the glass to create the rind for that particular chunk of obsidian, the rate is not uniform throughout the world because it's affected by temperature, you can determine the absolute age of the object. This technique is considered accurate up to about 500,000 years ago. Some other forms of dating used, but not as commonly, are amino acid racemization, considered accurate to about 100,000 years ago, which dates bone and shell by the rotation of amino acids, which can indicate the date of death of a living organism. And archaeomagnetic dating, considered accurate to about 10,000 years ago, which can date the firing of clay by looking at how iron particles in it have been affected by Earth's magnetic field. There are many long-term dating methods which are used for the study of prehistory that I've not mentioned, because I'm sticking with the ones that apply mostly to the study of ancient history. But if you are interested in the dating of older stuff, prehistoric archaeologists would be the ones to talk to about that. All the dating methods I mentioned are archaeological dating methods. That is, they help us to date material remains. But you know, there are also historical dating methods employed by ancient historians, like me, to determine the timing of events. And yes, archaeological and historical dating methods go hand in hand, but maybe in another video I will tell you about these historical dating methods, because they are interesting too. But somebody has to ask me the question first, so if you'd like to ask me that, or any other ancient history question, you can do that at speakpipe.com/davidmiano.
You might like my little e-booklet, Why Ancient History Matters. It's designed to persuade people that the subject is important, even in the modern world. You might also wish to use it to help spread the word. So feel free to share it with someone you know. It's free for anyone who wants it. I've left the link in the description box below the video for you to grab a copy. Catch you later.